वेलकम टू स्टोरीज ऑफ द लॉकडाउन, अ पॉडकास्ट बाय इंडिया स्पेंड एंड निकोर एसोसिएट्स। हियर वी सीक टू शेड लाइट ऑन वुमेन्स नैरेटिव्स ड्यूरिंग COVID-19। द पैंडेमिक हैज डिसप्रोपोर्शनेटली अफेक्टेड वुमेन, डीपनिंग प्री एग्जिस्टिंग जेंडर डिवाइड्स एंड सेटिंग बैक जेंडर इक्वालिटी। While each episode will have a different sub-theme, the broader focus will remain on women and their lives under the lockdown. For today's episode, I, Ruchika Galani, will be your host. I am joined by Ms. Sweety Desai, Senior Program Manager, BIEF Development Research Foundation. Welcome, Sweety, to the show.
Thank you so much, Ruchika.
So, could you tell us a little bit more about BIEF?
Yeah, sure. So, BIEF Development Research Foundation was founded by Dr. Manibhai Desai. He belonged to Gujarat. He was born and brought up here, and he was a disciple of Mahatma Gandhiji. And he had worked closely with Gandhiji during Quit India movement mostly. So, after the independence, Gandhiji had discussion with him, and Gandhiji told him that rural freedom will be when the rural India is developed. So, he gave the responsibility of development of rural India to Dr. Manibhai Desai, and he thus started his journey from 1947 for the upliftment of rural India. He started from Uruli Kanchan, which is a village near Pune in Maharashtra. First, he established a nature cure ashram there. Then after he started staying there and working closely with the rural community there, identifying and understanding their socio-economic and cultural context and what are the problems, issues that they are facing and what could be the effective solution for that. In 1967, the formal establishment was done for BIEF in the name of BIEF Development Research Foundation and was inaugurated by then President Mr. Zakir Hussain. Currently, BIEF is working in 12 states in India, and all of our projects are focused on the upliftment of rural underprivileged section.
Okay, so how did BIEF start working with women specifically?
So since its inception, Mani Kaka, as we fondly call him, found that the role of women is very active in agriculture and livestock. And since agriculture and livestock were the primary source of occupation or income generation for rural India, the engagement of women was always a priority for BIEF. But over the period, as and when the programs evolved and when the times changed, there was this specific attention to women and formal engagement of women in the program.
So what activities does BIEF conduct to help women?
So currently we work in four major themes, that is agriculture development, livestock development, natural resource management, and micro enterprise development, and women empowerment is cutting across in all these domains. So we have dedicated interventions where we train women in agriculture, in livestock. We provide them with technical handholding and assistance. Then we provide women with skill building in terms of stitching is there. Then there is a grinding mill or those kind of small enterprises.
Okay, what impact have your initiatives had till the present day on the women that you work with?
So mostly, if we see in rural India, what happens is like women are, like I said, very actively engaged in agriculture, livestock and other activities, but they do not have a say or they do not have the decision-making power. So because of our active interventions, they have been more involved in the decision-making and they also have a say in their households now when it comes to making decisions.
Okay, so the women that you work with are organized into self-help groups, right?
Right.
So what were some of the common issues affecting these women in self-help groups pre-pandemic, and how has the pandemic affected these issues as well as BIEF's activities?
So yeah, one of the major challenge what we faced during the pandemic was connectivity, because there was very strict lockdown and connectivity issues were there. But our SHGs were engaged, especially people who were trained in skill building. They were engaged in mask making processes. So because of that, they have been playing an active role in providing masks to the community, to even in some cases to the hospitals or the frontline workers. And if I say what a major challenge that we faced after pandemic was that because in rural area, the concept of smartphone is not that common. Also, women are not that free to use phone, you know, because it's a male-dominating society mostly. So, like in one of our project area, if I give you, for instance, we had a facility of providing training online, but the women needed to have smartphone for that. So initially they were not given smartphone. Then after through multiple field team and discussion with their parents and everything, they realized that this is more like a tool for their development rather than anything else. And after that, we were able to engage with them successfully. So that change or shift in pattern of thinking or ideology is what we have observed post-pandemic.
Okay. And you mentioned that you had to shift the goods that you were manufacturing during the pandemic. So how did COVID-19 shift the supply-demand landscape for goods that were being produced by these women? And what was the impact of this shift?
Yeah. So earlier, these women were engaged in, so if I give you another instance of our project in Saurashtra region, there are women were making leather bags, then purses, head, and some kurtis before COVID. Now, when the COVID came, of course, there was an immediate requirement for masks during the first lockdown. So we had to completely shift our production and focus on mask making, and we provided masks to all the frontline workers there. So this work initially during the first lockdown took a back. There was less demand, or you can say no demand, to the nearby market of rural area for products like leather bags or purses or handbags or kurtis. Now, after 1 year, even during second wave, this demand is not as it was earlier, but still we are able to manage to, you know, provide to the market, and there's some demand. But majority of the demand is of masks even now.
Okay, so how was it like for these women to adapt to this change in what they had to manufacture, and how did you as BIAF help them do that?
So the biggest challenge, you know, if I talk during the first lockdown, we faced was procurement of raw material, because you know that during first lockdown, the restrictions were very strict and there were challenges for arranging transportation or procuring of raw material. So our field team had to put a lot of efforts, and finally with their efforts, we were able to arrange the raw material. So that was the biggest challenge that was faced by this micro enterprise units, and we helped them in that. And they also needed training in mask making. So we had some experts, and through, you know, by connecting to them, we provided this women mask training through online or web platforms. Of course, they had done basics teaching courses, so they had idea of how this teaching and everything is there. But mask was a different product, so they needed some technical assistance to that. So we also helped and, you know, arranged that. So in that way, that was biggest challenge was, like I said, the raw material and then shifting the production. But they were very quick to adapt because they also knew that the demand is such. So during, I think in our Saurashtra region only, we had in 1 month, we had produced over 1 lakh masks during the first lockdown. So the time was such and the demand was such. So they also realized that it's high time that we quickly adapt towards the demand now.
Okay, so you mentioned that you gave them a training how to make masks through online platforms. So adding on to that point, what challenges did they face while adapting to learning these skills online, and how did they deal with these challenges?
So we have our resource person also there who are in our training programs but are now advanced students or are pursuing advanced course. So initially when they and our funding partners have also played an important role in facilitating all this. So initially when we provided them training, like you rightly mentioned, it was a bit difficult, but then we had some participants who had done advanced level of teaching. So they were very quick to understand and grasp it. So because of that, it has helped us. And another challenge was, like I said, that because in first lockdown, nobody was allowed to move out of their house also. So having access of smartphone to those women was the biggest challenge. But fortunately, with the efforts of our field team and the even key leaders of the village, it has helped to engage women through these smartphones.
Okay, what was the female workforce participation like before COVID-19, and what was the impact of the different waves of the pandemic and the subsequent lockdowns on it?
So before COVID, we had, let's say, in one of our center, we had 40 women who were engaged in handbags and then the kurtis and all. So what happened during COVID, the demand of masks, and this, they also provided bag for medical kits to frontline workers and hospital staff. So because of that, the demand increased. So we had to engage more workforce. So initially it increased as per the demand. Then again, when there was less demand and COVID situation was a bit relaxed, the workforce fell down. But then it was again more than what it was pre-COVID, because many women were engaged in this COVID lockdown, and they knew that they can do it, and their house, their family or their male of the household had also supported them, and they were also able to take decision. So if anything, we had rather seen the increase in participation of workforce. After the relaxation of first lockdown, we also engaged women in online training platforms only for some advanced level teaching courses. So now they are making designer apparels and designer clothes, designer bags, and in addition to mask and everything that they're still working on. So our products and portfolio has in fact been broadened. Advantage of online or e-skill is something which we have seen significantly, and engagement of more and more women, because they know that this is something that they can even do with sitting from their home. They just need some basic stuff or some basic resources or tools. So in a way, what we have seen is that there is an increase in production and increase of participation.
Okay, and how do you think that this workforce participation will be like in future? Do you think that the same trend will continue?
What we have seen is that if we are able to connect to someone consistently, they might get engaged with the program and they'll understand the benefit. But the biggest challenge is the market. Today, we have covered more than 500 women in our project area, and if required, we can provide them training in various teaching and other courses also. But we also need a market which will have demand of the products produced by them. So biggest challenge, if the market demand increases and if we are able to tap to the appropriate or right market channels, this trend would continue and people would see the benefit. But if there comes a time in between, there's a dip in the market, and then they'll slowly lose their interest and they'll not see the benefit that they were seeing for past 1 year. So then there might come a chance when we can lose this pattern of increasing workforce or increasing production. But market, as we all know, is quite volatile. So now we are putting our continuous efforts on market linkage, because production level skill building and engagement has been done. Now the primary focus would be how to engage them to the right market at the right time, because timing also plays a very important role in selling of produce.
Yeah, so could you expand on that? How are you trying to tap into the right markets?
So basically what we have done is, firstly, because this all women are located in the rural interior areas, and what our vision is that they should be self-dependent, that tomorrow if we are not there or our sponsors are not there, they should be able to lead this enterprise on their own. So first and foremost, we are looking for the markets that are near to their place, so the urban markets or even the state level markets. We have done some studies of retailers or big shops in the nearest cities. Then after, we are also looking at how we can link them to some online platforms like Amazon or Flipkart, which is still under process. So if that happens, what we are looking is that we can have a long-term partnership of market channels to them. Because if there's a demand from one retailer today and tomorrow is not there, their production will again come to a halt, right? So we are trying to have a long-term market channels, and at the same time we involve them when our team goes for market linkage, so that tomorrow if any from our team or sponsors, like I said, is not there, they are also able to develop those market linkages, that liaising with the retailers, that negotiation, that selling of the items, you know, all those things.
Okay, so what are your future plans for BIF? Are there any new initiatives or activities in the pipeline? And what is your strategy to deal with future waves of COVID-19?
If I'm currently working in 4 districts in Gujarat. So if I talk from my understanding and my operation aspect, what we have learned on this pandemic is that, you know, like I said, tapping the market at the right time. So now we have done significant work in production. Now we are focusing on markets, and we are also, you know, making them capable to lead the markets. So our long-term vision would be to make them, like I said, self-dependent and self-sustainable from marketing aspect as well. Today they can produce any designer cloth or apparel you want in a kurti or a bag, but they should also be able to sell it when, you know, they have, let's say, 100 or 200 bags. So our future vision is mostly focusing on now the marketing part. And during pandemic, what we learned is that, you know, the operational challenges that come, of course, keeping the whatever the rules and regulations are there from the government or the district or, you know, stay village unit at that time. So managing with those restrictions, how we can, you know, still be able to help to the society or community as a whole.
Okay. Yeah, that brings me to the end of all the questions I had. Is there anything else you wanted to talk about or you feel I should ask?
I just like to add a few things here. So while today we are at a level, you know, where we are talking of production and marketing, if I talk again particularly about the Saurashtra region, when we started, the community here was very resistant to, you know, women going outside of their houses and doing anything, irrespective of their economic standards. So they're rich or poor, women were not allowed to go out of the house. But today, after, you know, consistent efforts, we have reached to a point where they can, where women are able to go out of their house and engage in whatever they want. So that was, you know, one of the biggest achievement that I would say has been done. Secondly, you know, in personal life also, these women have now able to, you know, have a say in their life. So if I see one of the instance where one of our participant, she said that if I was not engaged to this enterprise unit, my father would have got me engaged and I would have been married by now. But because I was engaged in something and my father could also see the potential, I was able to convince my family that this is, I still want some time to be able to learn something, to do something on my own. And today she is leading that enterprise unit of ours. So there are many such short stories which are quite inspiring and which are quite life-changing, I would say. So if we see at a deeper level, these activities have more impact and deeper impact than we could estimate.
Yeah, that's a great note to end on. So thank you for taking the time to speak to us today. And I believe our listeners will find it extremely enlightening.
Yeah, so thank you so much. And it was really a great time talking to you.
Thank you. With that, we come to the end of this episode. If you want to learn more about the work of BIF, log on to bif.org.in. If you like the podcast, then do share it with others and subscribe to never miss an episode. Thank you for listening.